Hello, and welcome back to a very special episode of App Philosophy Weekly, where we unwrap the tech of today. I'm your host, Bram Schenk, and today I'm joined by a wonderful guest, Christian Selig. Now, he is the developer behind the award-winning hit Reddit client, Apollo. I want to start off. What did it feel like seeing your app on the big stage just 10 days ago at WWDC?
Pretty much entirely disbelief. I think I stared at the screen for quite a while before it set in. Because Will, I think, was actually the first person to text me about it. And I was looking at his message and kind of being like, what? You're kidding me. And my girlfriend, who was watching the keynote too, was like, no, Apollo's on screen again. And I was like, try to look between both. And I was like, oh my gosh, no, it totally is. So I think...
Were you already texting friend of the show, Will Sigmund, about it?
Yeah, he sent me a text. I just saw Apollo and he attached a screenshot of it. And I was trying to look at the picture and be like, oh my God, that is Apollo. I see the icon there. And then, of course, I hear, no, it's on screen too. So I quickly
what
looked up there.
And,
yeah. Oh, I couldn't believe
it. I was taken back. I'm like, wow, Apollo's up on stage. I was so happy for you when I saw that. Christian, how are you doing today?
Great. It's not as warm, I don't think, as in California, but it's here in Eastern Canada, it's starting to warm up a little bit.
We just broke 112 here.
I think we're at about 80 here, if I know my American units, but so we're not nearly as bad.
Now, one of the things people wanted me to ask you, the number one question is, okay, iOS 15's here. Apple's packed in a bunch of new APIs, both for iOS and iPadOS 15, macOS Monterey, and so forth. What's in store for Apollo, given all these APIs that were released? Can you give us a little sneak peek, a little background?
For me, I think the biggest parts, I think, are, well, one, as with all iOS releases, you've got to wait a little bit until iOS 15 adoption hits to use some of the cooler stuff. But even some of the other stuff like SharePlay, I think looked really cool. And I'd love to see if there's anything creative I could do there. They did a lot on the iPad side with keyboard shortcuts and not only the shortcuts, but the navigation where you can use your arrow keys a lot better and that whole focusing system. I was working on something like that independently. And the fact that it's caked into iOS now will make everything a lot easier on me.
All so, baked in, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And then Swift UI looks like another year where it got a lot better. So I'm excited to integrate more of that into Apollo going forward because it's always looked really slick, but there's always been a few little paper cuts that give me a little hesitance, but now it's looking great.
Now, we spoke a little bit about all this stuff off the show, but what's it like as a developer? Because you really have to, it's easy to get excited about what kind of APIs Apple's revealing and what's possible every year. But when you look at your statistics, a lot of people are still on an older version.
I think it's tricky because anybody sees like you have 1% of users say on an old version, mm-hmm. and you multiply that across your users and you say, oh crap, that's like 1,000 users. What person running a business wants to be like, oh yeah, screw 1,000 users. So it always hurts a little, but at some point you just got to bite the bullet. And especially where iOS 13 is compatible with 14, which is compatible with 15, device-wise,
yes.
There's no lack of support there. It's pretty easy to justify. And at this point, I'm crazy enough to still be supporting 12 just because there hasn't been anything that's made me yet jump ship. Like I'm on the cusp now, but I've actually got more iOS 12 users than 13 right now, which is because of the device compatibility.
That's
thing.
Interesting.
I think I just have to bite the bullet at this point and go 14 and 15 only.
Yeah. It's a hard decision that Apple puts you in a little bit because like you said, no business owner wants to have to make that call as far as cutting off users. Just a few years back, Apple introduced a new feature that will allow people who are running older operating systems to download an older version of the app. How does that work or how does that reflect? Do you log on there in the portal and say, here's the cutoff. If you're running iOS 12, you have to run an earlier version of my app.
I'm not even sure if there's any developer facing toggles there. I think it'll detect what version you're on. And if you previously downloaded it, if you go back to your purchases screen, it'll restore. But I don't think, and I might be wrong, if you search for it, I'm not even sure it'll show up anymore, and especially mm-hmm. I'm almost positive.
So when you look at features that were introduced, for instance, with iPadOS 14, where Apple was able to consolidate these tab views on the bottom that Apollo is famous for utilizing into list views on a pop-out menu on the side, is that something that you're waiting to implement until the bulk of your users are on at least 14?
Yes and no. That I love that UI style, and I think Apollo would benefit a lot from it. But I think that's saying too much with the iPad UI. I think I want to do something a little different there. I like the sidebar concept, But I think with Apollos, for instance, you'd have like the five items up there, and a good app would shove like a bunch more, like photos, for instance. And I think where I want to put some more things in there, I have things I might want to put in there that I think I might be able to do something a little more fun with than maybe the default sidebar UI, which is great, but I think I kind of want to just have a little bit more fun with it, but it's definitely coming.
I love that you really focus on creating distinct experiences when, as far as moving from device to device, whether it be an iPhone or an iPad or even the Mac. Fun fact, the iPad version runs on Apple Silicon Macs, which is so cool. That was one of the first things I tried to download when I picked up my M1, was to see if Apollo was there, because who wants to log on to the web version? One of the things, when I downloaded Apollo for the first time, and I think this was back in 2017, was when I downloaded it for the first time myself, it felt so distinctly Apple. Like, it was so well thought out, so clean. And you're thinking to yourself, this is the way that Reddit should be. Why can't Reddit's official Reddit app be this good? How did you start to formulate an idea of what you wanted this app to be? Were you frustrated with Reddit, their official app? What motivated you to create Apollo?
Funnily enough, it took me so long to build Apollo that not only was there not an official app at the time, there wasn't even talks of an official app at the time. like it was when I first started working on it back in like 2014, Alien Blue was still the big guy on campus, and it was still independently run. And I still remember like the day my friend was like, "Oh my God, Reddit bought Alien Blue. How does that affect your plans?" I'm like, "Oh geez, I don't know. I guess I'll just keep trucking on." And it went from Alien Blue independently owned, to Alien Blue bought by Reddit, to Alien Blue is the official app, to there's a new official app. And then I finally released. So it was a long process, and it wasn't anything against the official Reddit app or any app. It was just, there wasn't anything out there that kind of scratched my own itch. And I was just looking at the time I was just finishing up university, and I wanted a personal project to keep going with iOS and get better, because I'm a hands-on learner and I like building stuff typically. And I used Reddit a lot, as a lot of university students do. And it just felt like a natural fit for something I wanted to take a swing at. And at the time, there just wasn't anything out there that, like you said, had that feel like Apple built it. And which struck me as weird, because there was a lot of great apps, say for Twitter, like Tweetbot and Twitterific and whatnot, and Tweety, that did exactly that. Like, I love these that you just pick them up and you instinctively had an idea to use them because you used an iPhone. They were intuitive. And I just didn't feel like that for Reddit. As great as Alien Blue was, it just had some little paper cuts for me. And so I thought it would be an opportunity to maybe take a swing at it and hope it resonated with other people too.
So for you, it really was one of those things where through using things like Alien Blue or logging onto the web version of Reddit, there's something in the back of your head, just as you said, scratching an itch going, this could be better.
And especially if it's something you use as often as Reddit. Like, it's one thing if you're like, you log onto a to-do list for 15 minutes a day to log in some stuff. If there's a paper cut or two, it's fine. But man, if you're using it for like 3 or 4 hours a day, which, I mean, arguably you probably shouldn't, but if you are, those paper cuts start to add up and you're like, oh, if this was just smoother, like I use it 1,000 times a day, I make that interaction 1,000 times a day. If that was smoother, oh my God, like the payoff that would give me. And that was the basis for everything.
That's interesting. Now, when you see Apple introduced features, particularly with Swift UI this year, like async and await, a lot of average consumers watching the conference, the last half hour was a little confusing. They were like, is this a consumer conference or a dev conference? This is a little confusing. What's going on? What does async and await mean? Can you give us sort of the plain English version of what that means for all apps and maybe even your app, Apollo, moving forward?
Yeah, no problem. So basically the gist of it is, so many things you do in code are synchronous, which would be the opposite of that. And that's just a fancy word for saying it happens immediately. Like, you go 3 + 3, you'll hopefully get 6, and it'll happen immediately. Other stuff, like with networking, say give me the list of subreddits. I send that request off and I'm just watching my clock, waiting for that internet connection to kick off, Reddit to respond, and it to come back. And the last thing you want to do in that time is just completely lock up the app while it's waiting for that. Like, you want to let the user continue to scroll and whatnot. So you've got to do the task asynchronously, which just basically means in the background. And the tricky thing with that is, you've always been able to do that, but it's not the most, from a programmer perspective, it's not the most comfortable, and it's fraught with errors, because a lot of the time you're just you kick off a little thing where you say, hey, I'll be over here if you want, when you want to tell me when you're done, and then I'll hopefully re-interject back. And it creates this like confusing flow of where the program's going, where you have some stuff that's over here, hopefully waiting for this to finish. This other stuff's happening right now. And it's just, you have a lot of balls in the air, more or less. And the async await just, it hopes to flatten that all into making it one straight down. Nothing's jotting out in either direction. You're just waiting for the thing to happen, but you're not, it's a little confusing, but
it's my understanding is it's a more intuitive and linear way to
exactly linear would be the right
multitasking
word.
Processes to your app. There's things going on in the background that the user isn't aware of that's maybe speeding up a linear task, a straightforward task.
Right. In a perfect world, and I guess how human brains like to work is your program would almost go, if you're sledding down a hill, it's just everything's straight. It just, you get to the bottom, it's predictable. But programs with a lot of networking code can start to look like a tree where you've got 15 different branches going off in different ways. And then when all those branches are finished, trying to reconnect them back to the main trunk is, you're probably going to mess something up. And this is Swift's attempt at saying, let's try to take that tree and flatten it into something that's more of a sled.
Do you think we'll ever reach a point where anyone can make an app, and that is basically dragging Swift UI elements onto a simulator and puzzle piecing together an app just visually? Imagine not even having to touch code and just building simple list views just by dragging elements onto a screen.
That's an interesting question. I would say yes. And I think to a certain extent, you can do a microcosm of that in Swift UI currently. Like mm-hmm. you can drag in like the text elements and it's, you still have the code aspect, but it's smart enough to fill all those aspects in for you. As someone who hasn't looked into that area a lot, I'd almost wonder if the better avenue wouldn't be to make the code aspect just more approachable and more less scary to individuals. And I think things like Swift UI are doing a great job of that. I can't help but think that a lot of those drag and drop UIs are obscuring a lot of information that can help to conceptually understand what you're doing. And it's one of those things where if I can do it, like I don't consider myself a particularly bright person all the time. And I don't think code is that hard. A lot of people love to say it is and make it sound like it because it makes them feel fancier about their job, but it's fundamentally not. There's aspects of it that are for sure, but the base points of building an app aren't that hard. And I think it's like anything. Like if I told somebody who had never picked up a saw before to go build me a chair, they'd have a lot of trouble with that. But is building a chair difficult? I don't think so. It's just something that you've got to put the hours into and get used to the tools. And I think programming is just anything like that. Like a lot of people pick it up for the first time and they're like, dang, this is hard. You got to put the hours in. And I think Swift and Swift UI, I think would be very approachable. I think I could teach someone pretty quickly up to speed.
And that kind of leans into the next question I wanted to ask you is, for all those aspiring developers out there, where would you recommend they start? How did you learn to code? I mean, what was your journey like with that?
My journey definitely wasn't efficient. It's one of those ways where you learn about what to do by not doing any of the right things. I'd be like, oh, if you want to learn, you read a book. So I'd like sit down and read an entire book and then be like, sit down in front of my keyboard and be like, I retained zero of that. I read the words, they kind of clicked, but just nothing committed to memory. It's one of those things where it's helpful to learn how you learn. And for me, it was, I'm very much like a get my hands dirty kind of guy. So mm-hmm. I found much more than reading a book, which is useful, don't get me wrong. I found I'd be like, okay, I want to build like something really simple. Like I just want to change the background color of this view and basically make a multicolor flashlight with a screen. Let's look up a tutorial on that and then I'll try to understand it. And if I don't, maybe I'll ask questions on Stack Overflow or something. And then maybe challenge myself a little bit more. I'll maybe try to build a to-do list. And then you're just putting some like text on screen, basically. And I found that works so much better for me because I'd be applying it in a way that stick to my memory so much more. And it was just more fun than reading, like actually seeing things come to life. I really enjoyed. So I would say anything that as a beginner, I would try to find something that gets you building as quick as possible. And that's why I typically recommend Paul Hudson over at Hacking with Swift has a great like 100-day tutorial for a beginner. Like it's free. You don't have to have any programming experience. You just start it and it walks you through like the basics of programming, the basics of getting things on screen, and you're building little things as you go. And I think it's a very easy recommendation to make for a new programmer. And it's the kind of thing I really wish I had when I was around, because I was just looking at Objective-C manuals. It was rough.
there's so many resources nowadays. And I love that, because for all we know, we could be setting that spark, setting that fire within someone who's just listening to this show and is just wondering, where do I start? I want to build apps like Christian does. And that is so wonderful that you're sharing that. Did Reddit play a huge part in you learning how to code and do all this?
It's definitely arguably why I code today. I think it was more Apple at the beginning that got me into coding, just insofar as it was like the last year of high school for me, and I didn't 100% know what I wanted to do like going forward. And this was at the time when there was like all those, like there's an app for that commercials and apps for
yes,
the whole biggest thing. And I just thought it was so cool that you could like build something. And you heard all these little stories on the news of like this small guy from Wisconsin building something and putting it on the app store, and it beer app or something, and it got really popular.
And beer. I remember yeah, that.
Exactly.
You'd it hold the iPhone this way. And,
yeah. Oh, yeah. I swear that turned like a bunch of people into programmers, but I just thought that was the coolest thing.
As simple as that. Yeah.
Yeah, I want to do that. And it just, before that, like I knew of software as, oh, you could make a spreadsheet calculator on your computer or something. Like, it wasn't that glamorous. And with the iPhone stuff, it just really sounded a lot more exciting to me. So it's like, okay, I want to get into that. And I started playing with that a little bit at the end of high school. And I was like, yeah, okay, I'll go to school for computer science and learn this properly. Yeah. And that was it for me. And just naturally fell into the Reddit side of things.
That's very interesting. I could see, I was growing up, I was one of the first kids in school to have an iPhone. And It was one of those things where you not only did you feel like the coolest kid on campus, but you felt limitless with all this power in the palm of your hand. And there really was, back in the day, that sort of thought of, what will those developers create next? What will I be able to do tomorrow? And so there was definitely this Renaissance era of developers. And it seems like you were a part of that. That's what motivated you.
Yeah, for sure. It was like almost infectious. Just the everybody. It was such a fun time in computing.
Do you think that energy, that enthusiasm behind app development is still very much alive today? Or do you think it's plateaued a little bit?
Well, that's a good question. If it's plateaued at a much higher point than it was when I was in school, because I see so many young people doing, and maybe it's just the nature of the connected internet and it was always that way, but I see so many young people doing such incredible things like on Twitter and the iOS communities that I just, like at 15 or 16, when I was like, took me 2 more years to realize computers were a thing you could do for a job. And it's just, I don't think it's slowed down at all. And there's, like we said, there's so many more resources available for getting into it. And I feel like it's more accessible than ever before. And iPhones are so much more, and smartphones in general, so much more ubiquitous now than they ever were, that I feel like, I bet it's bigger than ever before. Like the enthusiasm still really feels like it's there. And there's incredibly cool stuff coming out every day.
And with Apple, I love that you use the word accessibility, because with these virtual events that we've had, as far as WWDC goes, Apple's Worldwide Developers Conference has been virtual for these past 2 years, these past two conferences, which is making all these developer resources more accessible than ever. Who knows whose interest you might pique now that these conferences are just showing up on YouTube, and all these resources and links to all this stuff are built right into the Apple developer app and baked right in. They're more accessible than ever.
Oh, it's incredible. And we have the Slack lounges this year. So you're just rubbing shoulders with every cool developer, the people who created Swift. It was really neat.
And more importantly, the conference was available to more people for free. You think about getting a ticket to WWDC, is upwards of $2,000 just to sit in that audience. And that's not even counting the fact that you do have to go through a lottery and all these things if you're not sponsored or part of a scholarship or something like that. Now, on the topic of accessibility, and we talked a little bit about Swift Playgrounds, I want to zero in on the iPad. Do you think, obviously, Apple introduced all these new features to Swift Playgrounds on the iPad to try to make learning to code with Swift UI more accessible? They were marketing this as a stepping stone to it's not quite Xcode, but you can run and simulate some aspects of your app on the iPad, assuming it's all based on Swift UI, which a lot of today's apps still aren't. How much of your app is built on Swift and how much of it is built on Objective-C, if you were to ballpark just on percentage?
Oh, it's probably 99% Swift at this point. Yeah, there's like a little legacy code that's Objective-C, but it's at this point, Swift's almost like 7 years old. It's pretty easy to have a lot of Swift code at this point.
So what do you see as limitations that are still there when it comes to Swift as compared? A lot of people are saying that Swift still has a lot of growing to do as compared to Objective-C, which is the legacy language.
Honestly, I would challenge that pretty hard. I don't think I've had, I'm very comfortable with Objective-C. Like, I built quite a bit of Apollo before rewriting it in Swift, and I have other apps in Objective-C. So I've had every opportunity to go back to, and the way Xcode works is it's not all or nothing. Like, you can just, you'd be like, oh, I want this random file in Objective-C. Like, it's very easy to do. And I've never reached for Objective-C in like the last 7 years. I think there's a lot of people that just Objective-C, some people have started using it like in the 90s, and it's just, it's their like weapon. Like, they know it inside and out. And I completely get that. And a lot of them are just wary to change over to something that is significantly
newer.
Well,
nobody likes change.
Exactly. But I think it feels a little false, maybe, to paint Swift as like, it's fine to be comfortable with Objective-C more, but I don't think Swift is in any way, at this point, 7 years in, really lacking in anything. Because I'd be cautious of a newcomer hearing that and being like, oh gosh, do I need to learn Objective-C as well? And then they're scared off with all these like crazy pointers and everything. And
that was a widespread idea in the community for a while for people who were curious about learning how to code, chiefly for the iOS ecosystem, was, wait, do I need to learn Objective-C to even understand Swift?
Yeah, that was a hard question to answer for quite a few years, and being like, geez, I don't know. There's so many great resources out there that are like written in like 2011 that are Objective-C only. So you have, even if you're like a Swift only person, like being able to go back and read those Objective-C kind of Bibles is very helpful. But at this point, they've almost all been rewritten, so it's a lot easier.
And they're like, less hands-on.
Exactly. And there's, honest to goodness, there's people out there that I would very easily consider better developers than myself who came in after Swift came around and literally probably couldn't write a single line of Objective-C and they know Swift. So I'd say if there's some incredible developers out there who only know Swift and only build in Swift, I think you're probably fine.
You mentioned at the beginning of the episode that you're a very hands-on learner. And I think today's ecosystem, even learning how to program chiefly using Swift, is a very hands-on process. A lot of people are starting off in Swift playgrounds, whether it be on the Mac or the iPad, and it really is a hands-on experience. It's type in a couple lines of code and see how this character on the screen moves, which direction will it go? Did you code this properly? And the bottom line is, and you're supporting this, is Swift is a very robust programming language. It's going to last quite a while. Do you think these features that Apple is adding to the iPad will help usher in the next age of developers? Do you think that's the solution? Or do you think the long-term solution should be just to find a way to port Xcode over onto the iPad?
I think any friction you lessen is going to have like a profound impact when you're at Apple scale. Like, you've got like a billion devices out there. If 0.0001% of them get into Swift Playgrounds because they're in the fall and it wasn't there the previous fall, that's a ton of exposure to something that wasn't ever there before. So I think at Apple scale, yeah, it's going to make a massive difference. And like, would I like Xcode for iPad? Yeah, it would be cool to have, but I'd almost wonder if there'd be downsides to that too, in that like Xcode can be quite a bit to wrap your head around at first. Like, there's a lot of menus, a lot of...
How do you make that touch first? There's a lot of questions to be asked there.
Oh yeah, and even if you could, how do you not make it like overwhelming as heck? Like, sometimes I see a settings screen, I'm like, okay, I have to read all these to make sure I'm not doing anything wrong. And just so sometimes it's just nice to not have them there. And it seems like Swift Playgrounds is just saying like 99% of these you don't need. You can port it to the Mac and run it out on Xcode there if you really need to, but we're just going to simplify things here. And I think that'll make it a lot more approachable to a lot of people who can just sit down and code and build the app they want without worrying about, oh my God, why do I need to edit my schema and change my build config and all this stuff? It's just, it's there.
And iPad's a huge deal. We heard at the conference last fall, Cook was saying that a third of people are still buying an iPad for the first time. This is still very much an emerging market as far as the iPad goes. You take a look at numbers from this quarter, iPad grew by 37%. That's up 7% from last year's growth of 30% for quarter one 2020. So quarter one 2021 grew by 37%. These are crazy numbers. And obviously, a lot of people picked one of these up because we were in the middle of a pandemic and you needed a video chat machine. But beyond that, we have to think about, what kind of tools do people have at the tips of their fingers now? With this many iPads in the ecosystem into the hands of this many customers, maybe we're ushering in a new era of programmers that will learn on the iPad and build their way up toward a Mac. That's not to say that more people have an iPad than they do a Mac. Those numbers still aren't there. But I think it's important because you start to zero in on the level of outrage that we heard. A lot of people were calling this last WWDC just 10 days ago. They were calling it underwhelming. They were saying not a lot happened for the iPad. Apple's neglecting the iPad again. What are your thoughts on that? And what kind of role does the iPad play in your everyday life, your ecosystem, as far as development?
That's a really good question. I sympathize with people when they say the Apple maybe isn't taking full advantage of what the iPad can offer. But all those people who say that, there's two trains of thought. There's either just let it run macOS, which that's one person's, that's a line of thought. And the other is it needs to be better, but they don't necessarily, like, nobody can seem to put like together like a coherent, it should be better in this way. It's just like this pie in the sky idea. It should be better. And the fact that nobody can come up with a full doctrine on what that should look like, I think speaks to how just difficult it is. There's so much baggage on the Mac that you just don't want to just throw onto the iPad and call it a day, because the iPad does do so many things great that you'd ruin by doing that. So I think it's an intrinsically a really difficult problem to make this thing that excels in its simplicity and not destroy that by making it too complicated. So I sympathize with both sides. I suppose it's very political, but it's a tricky situation. But for me, I use the iPad mostly as like a comfort device for me. So I do content creation on it as well. Like I'll answer a lot of emails on it. I do a lot of like exchange with people I find, and I love drawing on it and whatnot. I still do the most of the work on my Mac just because I find that a little easier. But if I'm tired of writing emails on my Mac, it's just nice to sit down with like the magic keyboard on a couch and bang an email out on your iPad. It just feels like less like work. And so I kind of just like my iPad for that. It just still blows my mind to this day to pick up this thing that looks like just like a little sheet of glass that is crazy powerful, beautiful, its colors are nuts, and it's just, you're holding so much computing in just like a sheet of glass, and it's so fun for me to use all the time. And that's, I just try to use it whenever I can, basically.
I definitely relate to that on such a high level. It's funny because people are always campaigning for more multitasking features, more multitasking. We need Windows, we need pop-up menus and everything else for the iPad. But every time I talk to people on this show, the number one answer is, I love to focus on doing one thing at a time. I want the full screen experience. I like to focus on one thing at a time, get productive, and just do. You know, it moves with your fingers. You're not barred by a keyboard or a cursor. They're there when you need it. But for the most part, you're doing these things with your hands, and it just makes it so intrinsically fun.
Oh, absolutely. And so it's tricky. I think for a lot of people, especially us outside of the techie circle, don't like the multitasking. Like you hear so many times where somebody will get into the multitasking view and have no idea how to get out, and then you get a frantic phone call. So it's like an anti-feature for most people. It's just us like edge case people that really want to push it to its limits. And I say that, but maybe having a Safari window up and a mail message up isn't the biggest power user. Maybe that is pretty typical, but it's tricky to do, like you said, in a way that you appease everybody. You don't want to shove the multitasking in everyone's face by having a windowing system like the Mac. And then, you get distracted easier. But you also want to make that accessible if it suits you. So it's such a tricky spot.
It is a very tricky spot. And I think Apple's doing a great job this year of letting the everyday user, maybe not the pro user, but the everyday user know that, hey, these features are here. You see these three little dots in the upper part of the portion of the screen centered on each app, each window, so to speak, that you're using. You see those three dots, and the first thought you're going to have is, what does this do? And you tap those and you see, I have the ability to tile windows, and before you're multitasking. So there's no gestures to learn. There's none of these crazy things that all we professionals or prosumers had to learn. It's offering up multitasking as an option. And I think Apple's hope is that more people will start to unleash the capability of what an iPad can do. But I love what you said about the iPad in that it's expected to be, when people buy an iPad, they expect it to be so intrinsically intuitive. And so when you have pros campaign for pro-like features that rely on things like plugins, that rely on things like Windows and simulators and all these different things that run in the background, how do you do that? Does the iPad need its own pro OS? And then how does that segment the whole market and what people have come to expect from an iPad? You want it to be intuitive right out of the box.
In a parallel dimension, I wish Apple would just release like a touch MacBook Pro and see, is this what you guys want? Are you happy with this? And just, I feel like a lot of people would just be like, no, this isn't that great. Or maybe just like a tablet running Mac OS, and they could see that like the other side isn't necessarily always greener. And I say that as someone who hasn't used it in that capacity. Maybe they're completely right. But I feel like it's such a tricky spot to be in, where merging those two worlds is so tricky. And I feel like maybe the solution is like Apple is keeping the Mac and the iPad separate for a reason. If you're like, I get more work done more quickly on the Mac, I wish I could do that on the iPad. Maybe the solution isn't to try to like shoehorn the iPad into what the Mac's already doing well for you. It's to say, look, Apple's building those products and they love them. Continue to use those. Everyone's happy. The iPad users, let's tailor the experience to what they want. But it seems weird to take a Mac user and like shoehorn them into an iPad when they're already happy with something. Like, well, why challenge a good thing? Are we saying Macs are going to go away or something? It's curious.
Well, I love that you mentioned that, because we saw Apple's previous VP of worldwide marketing, he's now an Apple fellow, Phil Schiller. He's quoted on stage saying, we have no problem with cannibalizing our own products. In fact, we'd prefer to do that before a competitor comes along and eats us alive. They had no problem with cannibalizing the iPod with the iPhone. And so when you have things like this, you start to question, why is Apple trying to protect the Mac by not adding functionality to the iPad, or at least the functionality we've come to expect? And then, of course, we have that comparison that Steve Jobs always made, where he said a Mac is a truck and an iPad is a car.
Yeah, no.
A truck, you can put whatever you want into the back of it, load up things and take them places. A car is just meant to go fast and in one direction consistently.
Yeah, he was the king of analogies for a reason. Like that suits so well. And I feel like if you tried to look at a car and say, like, how do we make this more trucky? Like, you're just going to ruin the car.
Yes.
And it's, so maybe that is the end game there. Like, the iPad's great at what it does and the Mac's great at what it does, and combining them, maybe that is tricky, because I think like Windows has their own thing where you can grab a Surface and it's iPad-y insofar as it's a detachable tablet. But I don't feel like a lot of iPad users would be happy with that experience. Like you said, a lot of the single pane, I'm distraction free, I'm just focused on this one thing, is the beauty of it, and having Windowsy experience, I don't think would make them very happy. So it's one of those situations where, man, you're not going to appease everyone at all.
I can also think back to Phil Schiller being on stage, and they had a whole slide dedicated to this. He had a whole slide, and he said, lots of people have asked us, why haven't you brought touch capability to the Mac? And the truth is, we've tried it. This is what he said. He said, we've tried it, and bottom line is, it doesn't work. People don't like to keep raising their hand and touching the screen. And that was their reasoning. And yet just a few years later, we have things like a floating smart keyboard, a magic keyboard, where you are raising your fingers up to push everything, because it is an iPad and the ability to touch it is right there. And not everybody is going to stay on the cursor just because the keyboard has that capability. It's right for when you need the precision and functionality of a cursor, that's why it was brought to the table.
Right. Yeah, no, that's a tricky one for me too, because like I say all this stuff about how touch Macs are weird, but like you use that magic keyboard setup for a while and you're swiping away, and then maybe I'm just dumb, but once in a while I'll pick up my Mac and then try the same thing before my brain kind of registers. And I'm like, or like a video of like a 7-year-old who's only used an iPad, sit with their mom's laptop and start swiping at the screen. And
you're like, it just feels natural.
Yeah. Maybe there is something there and we're just missing, like, maybe even if it's just swiping, like that should be a thing, because I feel like it's become an expectation enough that even if it's not the best experience, like maybe we're just old and crotchety and like that's just what it's expected of it right now.
It's funny you mentioned that, because a lot of people had reactions to macOS Big Sur, when it was introduced at last year's WWDC conference. And they said, this redesign looks very much like iOS, something that you'd expect from iOS. This control center looks very finger first. Is Apple finally going to bring touchscreens to the Mac? And I love that people were questioning that, because a lot of people like to define Apple as this company that sticks finitely to ideas, and they never waver. No, they stick to values. They stick to values and functionality and what people expect of their products. Steve Jobs is quoted as saying, is we don't get the technology into our hands and then go, how can we leverage this technology? No, we start with an experience. What do we want people to see? What do we want them to feel? How do we want them to do it? And then we see how the technology fits in. And that's where it starts to become like putting a puzzle piece together.
Right.
Pieces together. When you look at something like Big Sur and the fact that the icons and the control center and all the menus do feel touch first, do you think Apple's going to change its mind on this at some point? We saw that with the Apple Pencil. Steve Jobs said, over my dead body, we're going to put a stylus on there. We're built with five of them and they're right here. And all That's of a sudden true. Apple Pencil comes around and it's a smash hit. It has its place in the ecosystem creatively for people that are illustrating, or maybe they simply need that level of precision that the finger can't offer when they're jotting things down in notes.
Yeah. And I think that's the mark of any good creator, person, what have you. And I think Jobs was half decent at it too, was just, what's it like? And be like, okay, yeah, I guess I was wrong there. Especially with all with the Epic trials and a lot of emails coming out. We even had some from Jobs where you'd see him and like Forrestal talking, and Forrestal would have a good point, and Jobs kind of be like, all right, yeah, no, okay, that kind of that tracks. Okay, let's do it that way then. And maybe they'll have to go that way on the Mac. For me, like, my North Star is always like the traffic lights. If those get bigger, I'll be a little suspicious. Those still, man, I would not want to touch those with my finger. They're so close. But yeah, I think as soon as those get bigger, that's when I'll start seeing like the Mac people in the water kind of thing. But yeah, it's tricky. I feel, can I picture in 2040, like the Mac not having any touch input? Like, I just feel like it'll be so ubiquitous by that point. So it becomes a question of when. So I feel like, yeah, like I'd be honestly surprised if by, I don't know, 2026, we didn't have anything 5 years from now that was Mac-y. And
you mentioned the Surface line, and you say, look at how that worked out. That's not working out too well. It's not what people expect from a computer. It's great that it's touch first, but it's running watered down Android app. A lot of these things that are running on ARM, which is this new architecture that Apple's using to build their chips, this scalable SoC, system on chip architecture, they don't deliver what you'd expect even from a tablet of that stature, so to speak,
with
that chip, that silicon in it. And I think what Apple's really good at is building on foundational technologies. They really stick to, even though we basically saw iPad chips come to the Mac with Apple Silicon, they invented innovative new ways as far as how do you interact with Mac apps on a MacBook now? How do you do that? Can you switch the trackpad into a gesture mode? Can you map your keyboard differently so that certain things are more natural? So there's a lot of questions to be asked at every corner. Bottom line, do you see these things converging into one Apple OS? You think that's in our future? Do away with the whole thing and tricky. Just call it Apple OS.
Yeah, no, it would certainly make the marketing easier. Yeah, it's tricky. Like you said, I think like Windows has been trying that. Gosh, it must be almost like a decade that they've been swinging that bat now. Mm-hmm. And I feel like there are some people who are like singing the song, like, this is the best thing to ever happen to computing. This is my favorite device ever. I'm sure they're out there and you hear from some of them. But I agree with you that kind of just, it's the same as it's always been, that like mice are such a fine precision instrument for like people draw with mice, like crazy art in some cases. And you can just click on an like exact pixel and our fingers are just so much more blunt. And so it's like just the idea of marrying these two like polar opposite concepts in a meaningful way is just so, that sounds like such a gargantuan problem. But at the same time, it's, I don't see how you don't marry them as well, because who wants to be carrying around like 700 different UI concepts in their head? It would be nice if we could just all do one. So,
yeah. Well, these devices like mice and trackpads, they're so intrinsically a part of our workflow. We rely on them every day and we're used to them. As you said, some people feel more comfortable drawing with a cursor using a mouse than they do a stylus. So for them, the stylus isn't an answer, but we have all these points of input. And at this point, we're very much used to things like the iPad. And so the most natural and intuitive method of input seems to be just using your fingers. But when you need the precision of something like a stylus or even a pencil, the vision starts to cloud up a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's almost like we would benefit from having an Apple OS and whatever peripherals you want to buy for it, whether you just want to, like, imagine if Apple shipped you a Mac, okay, and it runs an OS that works across all their products, Apple OS, theoretically. And then from there, you can choose, do I want to use this whole iMac with just my fingers and hit the screen all day, like a Microsoft Studio computer, or do I want to buy just a mouse or just a keyboard? Is there an on-screen keyboard that pops up? How does that integrate with AR and VR in the future? Can I put on a pair of glasses and all of a sudden a keyboard, virtual keyboard shows up on my lap? It's really hard to distill a clear vision for what these technologies will be. And I feel like the cursor is so much a part of our everyday lives. When we made the jump from typing lines of code into a terminal to actually having a pointing device, that felt so huge. That was a paradigm shift in computing, chiefly for the consumer.
Mm.
And a touch-first interfaces are another huge paradigm shift for the consumer because it just feels so much more natural than trying to use a device and then tell that device what to do on the screen. You're just doing it yourself with pointers that are built in. So how do you maintain a separation between consumer and then professional experiences through one OS? Is it possible, or do you think there need to be, are we going to circle back to this era like Microsoft where there is an enterprise version of Mac OS? Do you think Apple will ever go there?
Like, that kind of seems like the worst solution, where it just feels like a cop out to have I'm in work mode and I switch a toggle.
Yes.
And a bunch of things change. That would work.
No one wants the future.
Yeah. Where's the fun in that? I would hope we could do better than that. And it's just, for me, it all comes down to like tap targets and whatnot. It's mm-hmm. just, you would need to make them bigger on the Mac in order for it to be a comfortable touch experience. And insofar as doing that, you lose a lot of the beauty of the Mac is just, there's no guessing. Like, you can look and you see all mm-hmm. the buttons. If you click them, it does this. Whereas the iPad hides a lot more out of necessity because the tap targets are so big that you can't have them on screen all at once. So it becomes this thing where, again, you have these two concepts that are fighting. And I wonder, and you can't just have it so, oh, as soon as you approach your finger toward the screen, it suddenly grows them. That also feels cheap. So it's, I don't know if it's a question of trying to find a middle ground between the touch targets being Mac, in that they're not mm-hmm. ginormous, but they're also touchable. But that's another area where I can't help but think, man, Windows has been trying this so hard for so long. And I don't see myself picking up like a Surface and being like overjoyed by the experience anytime soon. So it's so tricky. And then at the same time, the iPad seems like every year it's marching closer toward the Mac. Like, you look this year and we even have like the file and edit menu, mm-hmm. keyboard shortcuts and whatnot. So it's hard to not see it. Want a crash course toward the Mac, and maybe we just have to wait like 10 more years until it just keeps knocking more and more little checkboxes off. But it's
true. We see products like Apple Watch gaining more iPhone quality, so to speak, per se. And we know that the end game is not the Apple Watch cannibalizing the iPhone. People are always going to need a bigger screen. Apple Watch is built for quick interactions. But a lot of people that slap on an Apple Watch are finding themselves picking up their phone less and less. Mm. And so I think Apple's vision for the iPad is very much each one of these products has a place in the ecosystem. Come join our walled garden.
No, it's a pretty compelling argument. Yeah. And I see that with the watch too. Like, every year, it seems like with adding like the independent cellular connectivity and everything, they like the idea of you just being able to go for a walk with just your watch and even leave your phone at mm-hmm. home. And that sounds like a pretty exciting future. I don't think anybody looks at a device and says, I wish this was more dependent on something else. It's mm-hmm. just a natural extension, and why everybody was so happy when I think iPhones never, you don't need to sync them to iTunes anymore. That was such a pivotal moment in the iPhone's history. And now it's been, gosh, probably like 8 years since I last plugged my iPhone into iTunes or anything. So
you think about it, at the time, there was a lot of outrage on the developer end of the spectrum because it's, how am I going to configure the phone now? What am I going to do? And the quick answer of that is just plug it into Xcode. But for many prosumers, these professional consumers, which we talk about this extensively on the show, Apple developed this demographic on their own of prosumers, people that are scratching the surface of what these things are capable of, maybe not maxing these things out to their full potential, but really asking a lot of questions, constantly learning new things with their devices, testing the limits of what a MacBook Air can do. Can you edit video on it? If so, how many streams of 4K? And how does that change with the advent of M1? All these different questions. Apple's really developed that demographic on their own, the prosumer.
For sure. It's a fun place to be. I really like that they fostered a computing platform that you just don't sit down and use it, that there is that excitement about seeing how far you can push it and doing more challenging and fun things with it, because you grow as a person with your computer.
Now, on the topic of Apple Watch, Mark Gurman had a report, a leaky leak earlier this week, and he was talking about Apple Watch. He says Series 7 has a whole lot in store. Overall, it'll be a little thicker, supposedly due to better battery life. I'm crossing my fingers. He didn't say that, but it sounds like overall it'll be thicker, though the display portion, Apple may be using a new lamination technique that also not only shrinks the borders, but makes the display portion a whole lot thinner. So the device overall is getting thicker, but the display portion is getting thinner. So I think, to me, that means more battery life. So crossing my fingers.
Yeah, that's what I would think too. What else could it be? More sensors? I guess they've been so much talk around solutions for diabetic users and whatnot. Maybe they've got something there that would maybe run a slightly thicker sensor.
According to Gurman from Bloomberg, I'll start that over. And according to Mark from Bloomberg, he's saying that those features are still delayed as far as blood sugar, body temperature sensors. Apple's saving all that for 2022. He is mentioning that it will gain ultra wideband functionality to work very much like an AirTag. If you lose it, you can use that precision finding with a U1 chip of some sorts. We talked a lot about Apple Watch and how independent it's become compared with the iPhone. Can we see any kind of, I understand we won't get full feature, but any kind of light version of Apollo on the Apple Watch? Have you thought about that at all?
Yeah.
Is there a beta lying around on a thumb drive somewhere in your office?
There might be. It's one of those things where it's so tricky being like an indie dev, because like where it's just you and there's only so many hours in the day, you've got to choose each thing you work on with a lot of care, because but it's like that old Apple commercial from ages ago where like when you're picking one thing, you're saying no to another thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
there's a thousand no's for every yes.
Exactly. Yeah. So by saying yes to the Apple Watch, I'd be saying no to something else. And that's tricky when there's arguably quite a few more things that I'd love to build in, chiefly like a better iPad and Mac app that I think would garner a lot more use and love from users than the Apple Watch app. But it's something that I'd honestly love, maybe in a fantasy world in a year from now where I'm like, hey, I've done just about everything I want to do. That sounds like a really fun project to sit down and finish up. But it's tricky because for me, it's one of those things where I love my watch for what it does and as like a fitness device. But I've personally never found myself like sitting in a grocery store line being like, I'm going to scroll Reddit for a bit insofar as I'd look at my watch instead of my phone. Like that feels like a phone experience to me. And maybe I'm just completely missing the boat there. Like, I'm sure there's tons of people who adore that. But for me, it's hard to get excited about building something that maybe I'm not going to use. And that's like the most selfish sentence ever. But like,
but I think it's important. I think one of the reasons why Apollo is so cohesive, so full featured is because you're designing something for yourself. You're designing something that not only you'd be happy to recommend, but something that you'll want to use every day.
And I think that it really speaks to a product when you can tell like the people who build it enjoy using it. And I think if I was to use the watch app, or build the watch app rather, I'd have to sit there and force myself to use it exclusively for a week or two and just be like, oh, this is what people are talking about. Okay, this isn't so bad. And then I could get excited about it. But right now it's not something that I think I would use a lot, just because it's not how I personally use my Apple Watch. And it's not something I get a ton of requests for. If people were screaming for the heavens for it, that would be a different story. I'd probably accelerate that. But there's other things that there's a little bit more demand for that I'm trying to focus on a little bit more than that.
I think it's pretty remarkable. Again, when I downloaded Apollo for the first time, this felt, if Apple made a Reddit client, this is what it should be. It felt so full featured and so well thought out. No, I and that. And it's when I found out, wait, there's just this one guy named Christian Selig. That's just one guy that's behind all of this. That's astonishing. And it really speaks to your talent and your vision.
Thanks. It's, I think it helps a lot that I'm building something that, like, it's legitimately fun to work on. So many people, especially in the iOS developer community, they joke that we all create like a new Xcode project every week because we're chasing a new idea or something. But Apollo is so multifaceted between having a video player, like media playback, a markdown editor, like comments. Like, it has so many different aspects where if I'm like, oh, if I'm bored building this one aspect, I've almost got like a mini app in and of itself in another area that I probably have to finish up. So it's legitimately so much fun to work on that I feel like I can work on it for a full day, get a bunch done, and I don't feel like burnt out after a week. It's just the energy's still there. So I feel like that helps a lot more than maybe having a corporation with 10 developers who are kind of just building it. And again, nothing wrong with that, but they're building it out of, this is my job. I feel like it just brings a slightly different energy to the table. And the more I really enjoy doing this approach, maybe ends up in a little bit more productivity per hour.
That's definitely very interesting. I want to talk a little bit about the ongoing antitrust lawsuit with the whole Epic versus Apple ordeal. I'm not going to ask you to pick sides, but there is something in the news that's been circulating, and it's this whole idea of an antitrust law that has been introduced that would require Apple to ship naked iPhones. And by that, all you're getting is the OS, no apps, no pre-installed apps, no Apple Music, no Apple Mail, Apple Maps, nothing. You'd get an iPhone with a home screen, no apps on it. And then from there, you could sideload whatever you needed or go onto the App Store and pick which email client you wanted to use or which messaging client you'd wanted to use. How do you see, if this were to materialize, how would you see Apollo fitting into that kind of ecosystem? Would you market the app a little bit differently? Do you think Apple would invent something where developers can still promote their apps similar to the way they can be promoted now?
So
picture buying an iPhone and there being no apps on it out of the box.
Except the App Store? Like, we still have the App Store in this situation?
Except the App Store.
Okay, okay.
That's not clear in this law. It could be where they could keep with, there's rumors of all these portless iPhones, and that might be out of the question if this passes, because it might be back to where you have to take an iPhone out of the box, plug it in the computer, decide what you want to put on it.
Or maybe it's like when we got the CD-ROMs in the cereal boxes, like you got your own App Store with your Cheerios.
And yeah.
No, man, that would be weird. I honestly don't think, I find a lot of these exercises around, like, oh, should we have third-party apps or should we allow? They're all very interesting, like, academic thought exercises. For me, I can see why people would want that. For me, I don't think I'd do anything differently. I love that the App Store makes Apollo really easy to install. Integrating like a third-party payment system sounds like a nightmare of like logistical nightmares for me that I definitely don't want to do. So I feel like I could totally understand a bunch of people being like super stoked about it and using the heck out of it for their apps. For me, I don't think I'd do anything. If it was only the App Store, I'd probably still just keep doing what I'm doing now and maybe put up a few ads on the App Store for it and hope people download it. But fundamentally, I think I like the App Store model for what I'm doing, and it's worked, and it's worked really well for me. So I think I'd probably just, whatever guidance Apple would say, this is probably how you should handle this move going forward, I'd probably follow the advice.
So the fact that Apple does have its own in-app payment setup already configured for all apps that are on the App Store, including yours, is that an incentive? Is that part of the value proposition for you in choosing iOS as a platform? Because a lot of developers are saying, I have no problem. I can integrate things like Stripe or PayPal very easily. So why should I be boxed in? Why should I be forced to go by Apple's rules and give them a percentage of my earnings and things like that? What would you say to those people? And you answer that if you don't want to go there.
It's fine. No, it's a tricky subject. Like, I can totally see where those people come from. For me, it's I think for me, they're decreasing friction in any way possible. Like that's kind of like my whole thing with my app, and payment is like a big area. If you want somebody to pay for your thing and you have to make them jump through seven hoops, like a lot, I think you'll lose a lot of users just doing that. Would you lose 30 or 15% of your users? Like, I honestly think probably. I bet if I put up a screen in there, I was like, create an Apollo.com account, enter your credit card here. I'll try my hardest not to get hacked. Yeah. And yeah,
or the tap through like rate is what we should call
tap
it.
Through, yeah. Yeah. But no, I think most people would be like, yeah, I'm good. And then just drop out. Whereas with iTunes, like most of the time, it's like a single like tap the side of your phone and you're done. And that's invaluable for me. That being said, I get where some people are like, I'm glad that works for you, but maybe my model doesn't have the margins that allow for a cut as large as Apple's. And yeah, I totally see where they're coming from. And it may be a situation, if not a separate payment system, just letting you talk about how you can pay on your website would probably be a fair proposition.
And I think a lot of where this animosity comes from in the dev community is Apple does, from the very beginning, have a history of playing favorites. Things like Amazon Prime, where they were only taking 15%, not 30 from them, because they were a huge conglomerate. And it's, does that really make any sense when nowadays you have things like the small developer platform where Apple will only take 15% if you're making less than $1 million on your platform. So it's like they were giving, it's like an unfair tax break. You're giving more to the people that are making more money than the little guys, the indie dev.
Or even if they just, I feel like it would have gone over a lot better in a lot of people's heads if they were at least a little bit more upfront with that, insofar as saying, look, Amazon just operates on a different scale. If we want to keep them happy, this is what we got to do. Like, that's just kind of how it is, rather than it just being a little bit backdoor, back alley kind of thing. I think, yeah, I think everybody appreciates a little like upfront, clear, transparent policies around that.
Well, I want to thank you so much for joining us, Christian. It's been a blast. And I love that you're sharing your insight with the community here on the show.
Oh, it's my pleasure. This was a hoot. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm sure people already know this, but where can they find you?
On Reddit, I'm I am that is. On Twitter, I'm Christian Selig. And I don't know if I'm anywhere else. My website's christianselig.com. I'm typically Christian Selig everywhere except for Reddit, where I'm I am that is.
Excellent. That's where the people can find you. Go ahead and give Christian a shout out over on social media. You can find me over on Instagram and Twitter at Brahmshank. That's Brahmshank. Again, thank you, Christian, so much for joining the show today. It's been wonderful.
Genuinely, the pleasure is all mine. Thank you so much.